been a while since our last date, Batman. I thought you'd forsaken me.
Crime fighting leaves little time for affairs of the heart, Catwoman. But you're never far from my thoughts.
Those are the nicest words I've heard in a long time.
Speaking of words, I brought my handy copy of the complete Elizabeth Barrett Browning. After all, poetry opens both the mind and the heart.
I'm more interested in you opening these bars.
And open they will. After only 37 more reformative months, you'll have paid your debt to society and be a free woman once again.
Holy Romeo and Juliet! How much longer is he going to be?
Do you know the perfect way to cap this wonderful night?
Tell me, Catwoman.
Batman! Attention! Batman!
We're going to be late!
I'm sorry, Catwoman, but duty calls.
Welcome back, citizens, to an all-new episode of the Batcave Podcast. It's your old bat chum, John S. Drew, here, and we're wrapping up our From the Files of the Batcomputer here, taking a look all this week at those who are in front of the camera, so to speak, in the animated sense, and those behind the camera for the upcoming Batman vs. Two-Face animated movie. And joining me through this whole process has been the man himself, as he loves for me to say it, Mr. Dan Greenfield from 13th Dimension. Hey, Dan.
Hey, John. Yeah, upcoming, I guess, because I guess some people will have seen it by now on because it was available for digital download, but it comes out on disc on the 17th.
Right.
We at New York Comic Con last weekend, we had roundtable discussions, and if you've been listening along, then you already know the spiel. Basically, Warner Brothers had William Shatner, Burt Ward, co-writers James Tucker, Michael Jelenic, who are also producers of the show, I believe, and director Rick Morales, rotating among literal round tables in a media section at New York Comic Con. And we talked to all of them. And we've got the complete audio, so if you've missed it, we had Shatner the other day and then Ward. And now we've got all three of the behind-the-scenes folks that we talked to I guess it's a little bit of a lengthier episode, but each one of them is about a 10-minute clip.
Yeah, they were really interesting last year, too. So, Dan, who are we going to hear first?
Well, first we've got supervising producer and co-writer James Tucker, who's really terrific to talk to because he's got such a great institutional knowledge of Batman 66. And he had some very interesting things to say, including some of the producer's dream casting for a particular character who originally was going to have a much bigger role in this movie. And he also talked about the disappointment, or you listen, as you'll hear, the disappointment about not having Batgirl involved. So there's quite a bit to listen to. He also addressed the issue about whether or not there are going to be any further movies like this. So first up, I guess, is James Tucker.
Hi.
So to actually piggyback off of the question that I asked Burt Ward, he mentioned that people who are producing, writing, and so on in these films are Batman fans, and they're such deep Batman fans, in fact, that they know minutiae that not even he knows. I'm curious if you're one of those fans, and if that was what inspired you to jump on board this particular project.
I guess I'm one of those fans. I mean, it's not minutiae to me because I know it, so
yes.
I mean, I could take a quiz. I guess we could prove it that way. But yeah, I'm a diehard Batman fan, a Batman 66 fan in particular. I mean, it's what got me into comic books and animation, and you know, it's the first show I remember just vividly watching when I was a kid. So yeah, I mean, I lived and breathed that show. So yeah.
What was your reaction when you found out that they landed Shatner to play Two-Face?
Well, I knew we were going to ask him because when we started the first movie, there was so much planning involved that they wanted because to do the first movie was a lot of work, so they wanted to make sure we had two movies set to go just to spread the cost around. And so I think we had the idea to use William Shatner's Two-Face before we even knew what the first movie was going to be. And in fact, when we first approached Adam West about doing the movies, we also asked him how he felt about, you know, William Shatner being in it, forgetting that they had been in a TV pilot together back in the 60s. So, and Adam was all for it. And so, yeah, we went about asking, getting all that set up pretty much right away. So he was a lock before we even started the second movie.
Michael and Rick said that they didn't look at, like they didn't care about the unproduced Two-Face script that Harlan Ellison had written, but they said, you look at everything.
Yeah.
So.
Well, you know, that I did not, I skimmed through the book that was produced.
Yeah, the book was cool.
Yeah, and I thought Lin Wein did a great job with it. And it, I mean, Lin Wein's work on Batman is very evocative of the 66 show in its own way. And so we kind of, even though we didn't use that story as our, we didn't literally translate that story, we used, I personally used Lin Wein's writing and the way he treated Batman in the 70s as a way to merge darker elements of Batman with some of the campier versions. So in a way, we didn't base it on that particular story, but we did base it on the way he treated the character, if that makes sense. But no, I didn't. I hadn't read the outline. I've read Batman 66 scripts, just to make sure the words felt true. But we didn't. You know, the other thing is that, you know, they didn't produce that story for a reason.
Yeah.
So I didn't want to go down that road.
Yeah.
I thought we could come up with something that was, you know, equally or more true to the series, actually.
With the sad passing of Adam West, though, what's the situation with any going forward with the...
Well, we were only really planning on two anyway. You know, and it's always, well, we'll see how this one does, and then we'll do more. It was a strange case on this one in that they greenlit two movies back-to-back.
Yeah.
But beyond that, we didn't know what was going to be the future of the line.
I did suggest before that to maybe have Bert Ward as Nightwing.
Hey, I'm sure he'd love to do it. You know, I don't know. I mean, we'll see how this one does, because a lot of it just depends on the sales.
So. Bert was just here, and he just hinted that there might be more of something to come.
I don't know. anything's possible. I don't currently have any plans for more. We'll see. Like I said, a lot of it depends on the sales and the response to this one.
There was also some talk earlier with some of the interviews, and also it was fairly, you can't judge everything by a trailer, but it definitely does seem that this has a little bit more straightforward tone.
Mm.
Rick was talking about the noir aspects. What was the thinking in terms of, you know, slightly altering the tone of the second movie compared to the first, which was much more slapsticky?
Well, I think we took our cues from the first season of the series, which was definitely straighter, a lot more darker scenes, like more nighttime scenes. When in a way, it's weird because the first movie, Return of the Caped Crusaders, definitely was more like second season and third season in tone. And with this one, we wanted to go back to the more grounded first season, where the camp was there, but it was more, it walked a tighter line, you know? And so, you know, there's definitely more noir elements to this because Two-Face just lends itself, that character lends itself to, by necessity, it has to be a little more noirish. But it still has the same, there's still the humor, the wink, the tongue-in-cheek quality that the series had even in the first season. So it's not all that different than the series.
And I'd asked Michael also earlier the same thing. You've worked on two of these movies, and you've had an opportunity to do a lot in that period of time, but is there anything that you left on the table that you're like, man, I really wished I'd been able to do that?
Well, we didn't, you know, we weren't able to do Batgirl, which would have been great. You know, had we been able to get, you know, Yvonne somehow earlier involved or something like that, that would have been great. But it just, you know, we didn't know, you know, you never know how much time you're going to have with people. And, you know, that to me is something I wish we could have got to. But,
you mentioned that, you know, you've read a bunch of Batman 66 scripts, and Two-Face was kind of a holy grail for Batman villains who had never been done. Mm-hmm. Was there anybody else that you wanted to do?
Well, unlike the comics, I only want to do characters who existed in 1966.
Yeah.
So I wouldn't be interested in doing Bane or... Well, actually, well, I was going to say Harley Quinn, but there is a little nod to her in the movie. So, but there were plans in one of the drafts of this script. We had Poison Ivy involved, and it was actually going to be more of a Two-Face Poison Ivy team up.
Oh wow!
But then we realized we have William Shatner. We don't really need another character, and it just the story was getting way more complicated, and it just was getting bogged down, and so we put her aside. And. And I think it's a stronger story because of it. But again, we were contemplating. We went through one draft, I think, with her in it. So,
since you had already targeted Shatner for Two-Face, like, did you have somebody in mind for Poison Ivy as well?
We hadn't really reached out to people. We were, you know, considering like Barbara Eden maybe, or Anne Margaret. I mean, considering.
I was going to ask you about Anne Margaret.
Yeah. You know, because again, we wanted people who would have been cast in the 60s.
Yeah.
Barbara Eden probably more so than Anne Margaret, because Anne Margaret was a huge star, you know, movie star. You know, Raquel Welch maybe. You know, I mean, that was where we were going. But again, we hadn't gotten that far because we were only at script stage and it didn't go beyond that. But cool. It would have been cool.
Gary's going to kill me.
So. All right.
Thank you, James.
Who have we got next?
Co-writer Michael Jelenic, who also works on Teen Titans Go, and as a little bonus, he talked about that as well.
Now, with this, was this written in conjunction with the first one, or was there some time in between?
There was a little bit of time in between, but they were written pretty closely on top of each other. I think so. James and I wrote both of them, but I think I probably focused more on the first one. James was more of the this one, and we just sort of put our sensibilities got combined on the whole project. So, yeah.
What was the first time you became aware of Batman in your life?
Jeez, aren't you always aware of Batman? Like, I don't think I remember a time where I wasn't aware of Batman. I look at old pictures, and you know, even if I didn't know like the mythology, I was wearing Batman costumes, or you know, or I had to wear Superman, and my friend got to be Batman. And I remember being very upset about that. It's like, I'm going to be Batman. Like Superman.
Is it tough tapping into the sensibility of that show? I mean, granted, the first one had that sort of weird, darker edge thing where Batman became Dick, basically.
Yeah, yeah.
But in this one, is it tough to keep tapping into that sort of era and that tone?
I enjoy tapping into that era. I know it's not like necessarily everybody's first choice or instinct to go to with Batman, you know? But, I mean, that's like sort of Batman's origin, you know? He was sort of, you know, there was a lighter take. I know there were some early versions that were darker, but I sort of really appreciate what that 66 show, that sort of, you know, that tone it created. I think this particular one is a little challenging because the first movie, I think, is closer to what you sort of expect, and this movie has a much more of a noir feel. So you're putting camp with noir, and it's a little bit like, oh, I'm not used to this. And it's funny to see something like it's like the stakes seem a little more real in this one. Everything's a little more serious, and then you get those campy jokes, and it's like, oh, it's sort of, it's a fun mix, I think.
When you guys were writing and developing, were you already thinking about Mr. Shatner for Two-Face?
Yeah, I think unless I'm misremembering everything in my life, like, I don't think we would have done this without Shatner. So I think we had him pretty much locked in, or we knew that we were going to go with him before we started writing. So, and I think, you know, he influenced the writing of the character as well.
Yeah. What did he bring to the character?
Well, he brings the only thing that he could bring. I mean, is there anybody else quite like him who has that, those performances like him? And, you know, it's a tough character. You gotta, there's scenes where he's acting against himself, and it, you know, you don't necessarily realize it's one person because he's, you know, having so much fun with the character. So, I mean, you know, we wanted him to bring that Shatner-esque sort of like broad, big, you know, personality to this villain.
Any plans to work with any other sci-fi legends for future films?
Oh, man. I have lots of plans to work with some legends, but I don't know if they'll quite be as good as this one, right? So, yeah, I don't know. I mean, I don't know what the, you know, now that Adam is no longer with us, if we're going to be continuing the series, but it would have been great. Oh, now you guys made me sad.
Sorry. Yeah, has there been any discussion about continuing it with a voice actor who could emulate Adam West?
I don't think so. I mean, I don't think that you know, it's Adam West or nothing, right? You know, he's just so unique, and like his talent. I really don't think people really appreciate like the comedy genius of that series and end of Adam. It's like all that. I mean, I always compare that 66 series to Naked Gun. Naked Gun seemed like so revolutionary in like the 80s, and they were doing all those jokes, you know, 20 years before, where it's like they're not winking. It's like characters are all playing it straight, and you're trusting the audience is going to get. And then as kids, we didn't know that it was some comedy. It's like we thought it was serious. So it's like it. And I think a lot of comic book fans didn't like the show because they didn't understand it was supposed to be, you know, winking at you. It was supposed to be funny. So, yeah, I think Adam was pretty great.
So would you consider maybe carrying the series on, have Bert or Robin become Nightwing?
Yeah. Nothing would make me happier than a Burt Ward as Nightwing series.
Who's idea?
I'm going to pitch that, by the way.
My name's Phil Edwards.
Okay. Royalty checks go to. Whose idea was it to approach Shatner to begin with?
Probably my boss's. I think Sam Register. I think it's like who is the most iconic sort of major star from the 60s that if you could, if that 66 series was still going in the later series and they had a part for Two-Face, who would have you cast back then? And, you know, I think they knew pretty early on, it's like there was, you know, Shatner would have been genius in that, and then he ended up being genius in it. So
it's kind of cool we got these two extra bonuses from Batman 66. I mean, even if we don't get anything else in the universe.
Yeah, I mean, and I'm so glad that sort of Adam's last role is to play Batman, or, you know, he's not playing like a, you know, some sort of like, you know, I'd have him in other projects where he played the dad of Batman, or he played, it's like, I'm sure at some point he's like, I'm Batman's behind me, I'm never going to play Batman. And so for him to go out as Batman, I think there's something nice about that.
Has there been any talk about possibly doing animated films with Linda Carter's Wonder Woman?
Yes, there has been talk. I don't think it's going to happen, but I think we want to actually do, we discussed this, doing like aging up Batman 10 years and doing like Wonder Woman 77, so yeah. Like a, you know, Wonder Woman and Batman team up.
Which they did in the comics, yeah.
Yeah, so it would have been fun to see, you know, the how Bruce Wayne sort of like that version of Bruce Wayne aged up, and you know what his mansion looked like in 77.
Disco balls, mirrored ceilings, and a lot of shag carpeting.
Were you guys? Did you take anything from the Harlan Ellison script that wasn't used for the original series?
No, I didn't even look at it. I don't think. I don't know. I'm sure James looks at everything, so I'm sure he looked at it. I'm sure he looked at some other stuff, but you know, I think we were trying not to be influenced by that. If anything, we were influenced more by, you know, Dick Sprang stuff and you know, some classic Two-Face comics of the era, you know, pre 66. So.
Are you working on any series right now?
Series? Mm-hmm. As far as, well, my day job is Teen Titans Go, so that's what I work on. This was sort of a fun break from that. You know, just different tone, different world.
Any of the films, or just doing Teen Titans?
There's you guys, I'm sure, as comic book fans, are going to be excited to know there is so much more Teen Titans Go content coming out.
Yay!
I know it's not the crowd, but...
Oh, I like Teen Titans.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you. Nobody's putting you down for it.
We got a theatrical movie coming out next year.
Mm-hmm.
Which one?
Are you, are you?
Oh, right.
What's your role going to be in that big screen version?
Producer and writer.
Okay.
So.
Cool. Is the approach different for that? Like, I mean, because obviously Teen Titans Go is so kind of rapid fire with its humor. How are you going to stretch that to 90 minutes?
Yeah,
right. Without exhausting everybody.
Do you know?
Yeah.
Let me write this down.
I mean, because that's like a high jokes per minute ratio on that show.
Yeah, the movie I think is high jokes, but, you know, in 11 minutes, you don't really have to take the characters that seriously. At least we don't. So once you expand it, it's like, Robin has to be a little bit more likable, and you know, so we're really trying to focus on character stories. You know, otherwise it's just sketches for 90 minutes. But yeah, we're trying to make you care about the story. Maybe that's a mistake for this brand, but
do you know if this live action Titans thing they're doing is it influenced by Teen Titans Go, or is it because the character, the actors are all very young?
Yeah, I'm sure. I think everyone's probably surprised by the popularity of, you know, Teen Titans. So I think it's influenced in some way, but I think it's gonna be a different, it's not gonna be a comedic version. It's gonna be, I think, what you know, a lot of comic book fans want to see from an animated series, so they'll get that in a live action version. So
back on Batman, you've done two of these movies now, and you've gotten to do, judging by the first one, you've hit a lot of different points. Is there anything that was kind of left on the table that you wish that you'd been able to get to, having done two movies, but never got a chance to really kind of hit on?
The only thing I miss from the two movies that I wish we did was the window cameos. You know, that just ended up being too much work. It's like, oh, you have to write it to somebody, and then you have to find if that person wants to do it, and it has to be someone specific of an era, and there are only so many of those people. But I thought that would have been fun to get in there, and we just weren't able to pull that off.
These movies, well, I haven't seen the new one, but Return of the Caped Crusaders had kind of like this weird sense of time and place to it, where it's not 1969, 1970 necessarily.
Yeah.
You know, it's like kind of today. It's not. So what, how do you approach this in terms of, it's not really Batman 66 season 4, is it?
No, you know? I mean, it's inspired by 66, but I mean, like, I know some people were watching the first one, it's like they got the layout wrong. They got this thing wrong. It's a little confusing because there's some aspects like, oh, the Batmobile is exactly the same, but then we changed the look of, you know, the mansion, or the Batcave has equipment that's swapped out. But that's because we were trying to do something that's different. It is, like you said, it's not a continuation. We're trying to make it, you know, its own thing. In the second one, the weirdness of time and place is even pushed, I think, a little bit more, because it's got like a film noir, you know, so it's like you have that 66 feel, but then suddenly with that film noir, I mean, it's shot in quotation, it's like a 1940s movie, and so you got all these different sort of juxtaposition of tones and styles, so it's pretty interesting.
Yeah, you know, getting into Teen Titans myself here. So, as we come to the end of this, who have we got for our final interview?
The person who's always the last in the credits, the director, Rick Morales.
Right. All right, here we go.
Working with William Shatner on Countdown. It was incredible. It was kind of giddy about the whole thing. it was amazing. I mean, you know, I was saying before that we generally do the voice records before we start the storyboard process most of the time, and we were lucky to have done that on this one, because the performance that he, you know, created for Harvey and Two-Face is just, I think Two-Face is, it's probably it's my favorite Two-Face. I just think he had such a great voice quality to it, and we definitely keyed off of that for, you know, the acting and the storytelling and trying to get some of the William Shatner acting into it, you know. So it was great, you know, to be able to work from that. It's just such a strong base to start from.
How much
much fun is it to dip into this era? You know what I mean? Of this sort of...
It's amazing. It's this is what kind of got me into Batman as a child, you know? So, you know, being able to have a voice cast of Adam West and Burt Ward and then William Shatner on top of that, it's just... You know? I love it. It's a dream come true for me, and I was just very happy to be able to be a part of it.
How was Adam, you know, I mean, did you guys sense that he was ill or anything when he was recording?
I had no idea. It was a complete shock to me. I heard it when you guys heard it, and in the way that you guys heard it, and it was just awful. Yeah. But you know, at the same time, it was I was very fortunate to have been able to meet him and work with him, and you know, always be thankful for that.
Michael said that this one has kind of a little bit more of a film noir tone, like it's a little bit more serious than Return of the Caped Crusaders.
Yeah.
Was that your intention from the minute this was conceived, or did that come about as you were going?
No, it was like the earliest conversation I had with producer James Tucker actually, I don't even think they had started. It was probably right after New York Comic Con last year where we were talking about it, and he was like... he's like, yeah, I think we're gonna just do like something more like Batman the Animated Series on the next one, you know? It's like Batman the Animated Series, but with the Adam West Batman, in, you know. And I was like, oh, that's interesting. I don't know how that's gonna work. And then I saw the script and we started in on it. And I was like, yeah, okay, this makes a lot of sense. It is darker. There is a little bit more film noir, but you know, at the end of the day, it's still The Bright Knight. So,
did you have a favorite? Like kind of, there's all these crazy background gags and modern pop culture references in the first one. Do you have a favorite, and are there ones we should look out for in this one?
In this movie, I was trying to think.
Or in the first one, you don't have to spoil anything.
Oh well, let's. My favorite little bit in the first one, I think on that end, is the little Catwoman dig at the Dark Knight. Yeah. In the, you know, that I like that whole, like, you know, go to Paris and this and that. I think that was funny. This one has some of that in it, but probably not as great. You know what I loved about the last one too was all the references to the Frank Miller Batman and to the, you know, to Batman 89, Michael Keaton stuff. Like, I thought that was all kind of cool. To see that Batman go dark was kind of funny.
What's your own grounding on the 1966 show?
As far as, like, how I watched it.
Yeah, no, well, I mean, is it something that's particularly important to you, or is it just yet another version of Batman that's out there?
No. Like I said, you know, I remember my earliest moment watching it was, I remember in the summers, my older sister and I would... it was like a routine. It was in reruns in the afternoons, and we would watch it. And we took it deadly serious, you know, when it went to, you know, the episode ended, and they're all two-parters, and they were trapped, and you were like, oh, my God, how are they going to get out of this one? And it was deadly serious to us. I watched all that stuff. I even still have an old book that my uncle gave me from mid-'80s or something like that was a collection of all kinds of like background facts on the show and this and that, and I hadn't seen it in years until I was working on the last one, and I dug it out in my boxes and boxes of comic books, and I had it sitting in my office, you know, looking at it. It had a great list of all the holy sayings that Burt Ward used to say as Robin.
Joe Eisner,
you know? Yeah, you're right. Yeah, yeah. It's that one. And so it's sitting there, and then my 2-year-old walks into my office and she grabs it. And she rips the cover right off, and I was like, "Ah!" No. But yeah,
she holds out of the house now.
Kicked her straight out. She's on her own.
So what's your next animated feature? Like, what's your next project after this?
The next thing, I don't know that I should really say, but I've been working on a lot of. Well, I guess the one that's coming out next would probably be it's a Lego thing. I've done a lot of these Lego DC superhero ones and the Lego DC superhero girls, and just had a Lego Lego Scooby-Doo. So I'm firmly entrenched in the world of Lego animation right now.
What's the appeal of that for you? I mean, obviously, people love Lego. For you personally, what's the appeal of Lego?
You know, it's funny. It's funny. Well, you know, I come from a background. I've worked with James before. He's one of the first producers I ever worked with in my animation career on Justice League. And did a lot of, you know, straight action type stuff. And the Lego stuff was more comedic, right? I mean, that Batman is probably a lot closer to this Adam West Batman, so it's not completely removed from it, you know? There is something there that's similar. But you know what? To me, it's just, as I get older as well, and having children now, being able to work on something that's still has action in it, still has superheroes in it, but is fun and accessible to all ages is great.
Once you decided on that kind of more noirish tone, what was the process in going back and forth of how much noir versus how, you know, lighter people were expecting? And what was the process of, like, finding that balance, actually?
You know, I can't say that I really made a concerted effort to kind of pull it away from that ever. Mm-hmm. We just went with it. And it actually was probably a lot more natural for the crew to kind of do than actually the last one, because the last one, you know, was very much an homage to the old series, and we did a lot of work with camera angles and things like that to try to take it into that world. And this one was more like more stuff that we are very comfortable and familiar with doing, you know. So actually, I don't say any of these are easy, because it's all a process, but this was easier. It was more enjoyable because we knew what we were doing, we knew how to do it, and we had done the last one, so there was familiarity.
Was there a concern, though, that because fans are a particular bunch, particularly, you know, anybody who really loves a certain way of doing things, was there any concern that this might alienate some longtime viewers of the show who are expecting one thing and then may end up getting something else?
I don't think so. I mean, I won't be the judge of that, obviously. The you know, fans will, people that watch it. I don't think it's so far removed from the last one that there's any danger of that. It's just kind of, it's a little darker, it's a little more mysterious, and that's, you know, it's still Adam West Batman, it's still Burt Ward as Robin, it's, you know, so I didn't ever really have that concern as we were making it. Like, this is totally going to alienate anybody. They're still camp, you know. This, so
the TV series and also the first movie, there's a lot of almost risque humor in it. Like, there's stuff that works for adults that kids just wouldn't get. Is there anything that you guys tried to get into the last one or into this one where Warner Brothers was just like, all right, guys, you can't. You just cannot do that. Right.
No, we actually got it in.
What was it?
I'm not going to say. so, yeah, no, I can't blow it. But
okay.
But, yeah, no, all kidding aside, like, I don't ever want to really... That's not who I am. That's not what I want to do personally. But there is stuff in there that, you know, that is for adults, you know.
Yeah.
And and there's definitely stuff in this one, but it's, you know, nothing vulgar or anything like that.
Yeah.
So
it was suggested to Michael before that it should be the Burt Ward Nightwing movie. What do you think of that idea?
That's hilarious. I never thought of that. Yeah. I told Burt Ward this on the first one, that my favorite character as a kid, and still to this day, is one of them, is Robin, and that's based on Burt Ward's Robin, because was my first introduction to that character. And so on the first movie, I remember we were sitting there, during a lunch break at the record, and it somehow it ended up so it was just him and I, and we were talking about Robin, and you know, very seriously having this conversation about how important Robin is to Batman, you know, lightening him up and giving an access point to children and all that. And I remember just sitting there thinking, like, talking to Burt Ward about Robin.
Yeah.
That's a fun idea.
Yeah.
Gets credit.
There you go.
This was really cool. And the audio was even better this year than last year.
Yeah, for whatever reason, we were able to get – I mean, I think part of it was we were able to get our mics a little bit closer, so everything sounds a lot better. Although you always do hear these weird references in the background whenever you listen to audio like this. This was great. I guess the big question, of course, is whether or not we're going to get any more of these. As you heard in all these interviews, this discussion, and, of course, earlier this week you heard Burt Ward, you know, teasing the possibility of something. My sense is that we're probably done here, and I think that in a bittersweet way, I think that this wave of Batman 66 mania, I think is starting to fade a little bit. Someone was asking me the other day how much Batman 66 stuff I saw at New York Comic Con this year, and there really was not much. We still have some wonderful things coming, like Factory Entertainment's Batcave is still coming, and Funko's continuing with their action figures. But the idea of maybe a third with someone playing Adam West's role, another movie, I would tend to doubt it. But, you know, I've been surprised before, so you never know. Although I also do hear that there is the potential for another Batman 66 comic being produced as a crossover between DC and another company. But that has not been confirmed.
Hmm. Yeah, I wouldn't mind seeing some more Batman 66 comics, but... That's a shame. I mean, obviously, when you have these nostalgia waves, they come and go, and it doesn't last forever. But,
no.
You know, being the host of this podcast, it's like...
Well, the people who listen to this podcast and the people who read these stories on 13th Dimension, they're not going away.
Right.
you know, that's – I mean, I guess we all are going away eventually, not to be, you know, morbid. But, no, I mean, the point being is that the fans will always exist. It just – I remember in other years, over the last few years, where there were a lot more – there was a lot more Batman 66 stuff around, particularly 2 years ago. But, you know, still, I mean, it was great. Everywhere I turned around, there were still people dressed up like, you know, Robin from the movie or Batman from the movie. So we'll see what happens from here.
Right. So as we wrap things up here, Dan, obviously this coverage, as you mentioned, will continue over at 13th Dimension.
Yeah. I mean, we've covered a lot of these, points and some others as well, reviewing the movie, which, I guess that'll be our next, episode of, the Batcave podcast is going to be a review, I guess, right?
Right. Exactly. You, me, and a couple of the, old gang will be getting together. And just like we did with Return of the Caped Crusaders, we'll break it down for you. The good, the bad. I'm hoping... Although, you know, I don't think it's going to be an issue. There shouldn't be any ugly with this. So we didn't find anything ugly with Return of the Caped Crusaders.
No, although this is going to be interesting. And again, as you've heard, you know, through all of these interviews, and, you know, some of your listeners may have already seen the movie by the time we talk about this, is the different tone between this movie and the first movie.
Right.
And that's something to watch out for, because as James Tucker said, and you just heard, they went to kind of the first season approach with this movie, as opposed to the first, Batman vs. Two-Face kind of reflects the first season, whereas Return of the Caped Crusaders was more slapsticky and sort of kind of echoed the second and third seasons.
Right, right. And we'll have that review for you in just a couple of days, folks. Stay tuned to the feed. Stay tuned for all the great episodes we're doing here on the Batcave Podcast. Soon we'll be getting back into our reviews of The Hornet's Sting with the Green Hornet. And Dan and I will also be back with new reviews of the 68 Filmation cartoon. So until then, folks, thank you so much for listening. Once again, Dan, citizens, take care, everybody.
Thanks, John.
Thanks for listening, chums. I don't have a bat phone, but you can contact the Batcave Podcast through its Facebook page, Twitter, email at thebatcavepodcast@gmail.com. Subscribe to the podcast via Libsyn.com. That's Libsyn.com. Or through iTunes. The Batcave Podcast is part of a series of pop culture podcasts from the Chronic Rift Network. Find them at chronicrift.com. So until next time, citizens, same bat time, same Batcave Podcast.